Hello，大家好，现在听得到我的声音吗？可以哈，好，大家点头，嗨，非常欢迎大家今天参加我们世界台湾同乡会联合会所举办的台湾重定位岛屿新坐标系列活动的第一场活动——曹永和院士的隐藏文本。我们的活动包括一部线上的放映的纪录片，还有两场座谈会。那上个礼拜的第一场，我们谈的是多嗓时代的台湾人图像。今天我们要谈的主题是台湾岛史30年，岛屿史观还有海洋史观对于台湾史学的发展。那第一场我们是聚焦在谈曹老师的个人经历，还有他所处的那个时代。第二场我们今天要谈的是他提出的台湾岛史的意义，还有之后对台湾岛史、台湾史学发展这个三十年之间的影响。好，那我今天很高兴看到线上已经有非常非常多的来宾，还有我们的会员朋友们。我这边看到除了我们三位来宾以外，我们还有加拿大。非常早起，非常早起的哈，今天大概5点就早起的，我们上个礼拜就在的哈，蔡春松蔡前辈，还有我看到我们侨委会的简秘书也在线上，要不要跟我们打个招呼？简秘书， 他在挥手，嘿，然后还有我们的，我看还有我看到的是狮龙委员是吗？法国的狮龙狮委员，然后还有我们在美国的谢济老前辈，还有我们奥地利的朋友、日本的朋友，还有很多现在没有秀出名没有秀出影像的人哈。好，那大家好，然后我想先再介绍，在我们开始之前我先介绍一下我们今天的工作人员，冠伟，吴冠伟，这是我们这一次节目筹划这个系列非常出最大力量的吴冠伟。吴冠伟是波鸿大学的博士生，也是历史学的博士生。然后我们还有林宏璇，林宏璇是在德勒斯登念化工，好像每次都讲错哈。对，然后宏璇也是我们这一次的策划这个活动的主要的伙伴之一，然后也替今天也会在现场帮我们处理一些技术上的问题。然后还有燕琪是我们学术部的负责人，然后也是在波昂大学，现在在做波昂大学在做学术研究的一个 project。好，他是波昂大学政治系的硕士，然后现在是从事学术计划的研究。然后还有我们碧玲在加拿大。是我们这次的技术总监，给我们非常多的意见。那我们有这么多工作人员在现场的话，就是希望今天的工作可以，今天的会议可以进行得非常顺利哈。所以我们就是希望说，大家如果没有要讲话的时候，就把麦克风关掉。好，然后我们今天的座谈会，我们先由主持人还有三位来宾，就是主持人跟来宾一起先做一个简介，然后之后的话，我们会有足够的时间让大家发问，然后发问的方式的话呢，我们就是您在下方，我们在视讯平台的下方有一个留言板，如果您要发问的话，麻烦您在那边留一个言，说我要发问，或者是如果您不希望说自己问，您也可以把你的问题写好，然后让我们的宏璇到最后帮大家朗读这些题目。好，我想现在我们就先开始，就先进行我们今天的活动。我相信在座很多人都已经看过曹老师的这一部纪录片。好，这部纪录片已经从13号开始放映，然后放映到今天，已经网线上观看的人数已经超过1000人。然后我们接下来会放映到31号，就是还有4天的时间可以让大家观赏。我想看过纪录片的人，大家都会也许有注意到，就是陈翠莲老师他回忆一段曹老师讲过的话，他说：“我希望以后可以留下来的，不是曹永和的研究做得多好多突出，而是如果我可以带出一群学生，一起把台湾史的研究做得又深又广的话，可以在各个领域深入的发掘。如果我有一天可以带出这样一批学生的话，那么我曹永和在台湾史的研究就会有价值。”那我想，我们今天我们的三位来宾，正好是印证了曹老师自己所说的这句话。我们今天邀请到荷兰的包勒史包教授，还有台湾中央研究院副研究员张龙志张老师，还有郑维忠郑老师，这三位都是曹老师的学生，在他人生三个阶段不同阶段的三位学生。那我想他今天如果知道，他看到这么多，不仅是这三位非常突出的学者，还有许多许多台湾史研究的学者都是他的学生，我想他应该是会非常高兴的。那 我们今天就来先一一介绍我们今天的三位来宾。第一位是曹永和老师，最活泼可爱的学生包乐史包老师，包教授 ，Professor Brucey。这个活泼可爱不是我讲的，是我们的我们的会员他们在看完纪录片以后说，他们觉得对包老师的印象非常非常的深刻。包老师在退休之前是荷兰莱登大学的历史系教授，也曾经兼任过欧洲扩展史研究中心的主任，荷兰国际亚洲研究新的主任，然后也在台湾、美国还有日本的各个大学授课，同时也是日本福冈文化奖的得主。他主要研究的领域是东亚史、南洋史，还有海外的华人史。那第二位是郑维忠教授，郑维忠教授也是中央研究院台史所的副研究员。郑维忠教授，是曹永和老师的学生，也是包老师的学生。那他主要研究的方向是荷兰时期的台湾史，还有海洋史。那最近，郑老师也出版了一本，历史的畅销书《海上佣兵》，17世纪东亚海域的战争贸易以及海上劫掠，主要是谈郑芝龙、郑成功、郑经他们郑氏家族在17世纪如何在东亚海上建立起自己的对外的贸易，以及那当时的环境。第三位我们要介绍的是，也是今天的主持人，而且是我们台湾目前最新的馆长。张龙志张老师，张老师是台湾中央研究院台湾史研究所的副研究员，同时也是兼副所长。然后再过几天，他就要到台南去接任国立台湾历史博物馆的馆长，所以我说他是台湾现在最新的馆长。我们首先，我们知道这个消息的时候呢，我们首先要恭喜国立台湾博物馆可以得到这么好一个馆长。然后我们也看到文化部部长李永德先生，他说他期待张龙志老师可以带领台湾历史博物馆，以世界中的台湾为定位，让大家更了解自己国家的历史，也要让台湾的历史价值，跃上世纪的舞台，成为台湾和国际对话的重要平台。那我们看到这句话以后呢，我是深深相信李永德部长呢，一定是有偷看到我们的文宣《台湾重定位岛屿新坐标》，他已经有听到我们的心声。所以我接下来也是要恭喜我们自己，相信以后张老师一定可以继续给我们世台会非常多的意见还有指教。当然我最后也要恭喜张老师，您以后就可以住在全世界最美丽的城市台南市。您早上呢就可以先去吃萨瓦西姆，然后中午可能没办法，中午你那个地方离市中心太远了，我算过，你如果要从那边到台南去吃，我们台南的大菜系里面的名产的话，你需要有8.7公里，这个时间段是比较久一点。不过晚上的时候，当然您又可以回到美丽的台南市。那张老师，是哈佛大学历史学的博士，专注的领域是台湾社会文化史、平埔族的族群史，还有比较殖民史。然后呢，近年来您也很关心史学史的研究。史学史我们可以理解成历史学的历史吗？是这样子理解吗？我们现在我想，我就把座谈会的主持交给张龙志张老师，谢谢张老师。
好，大家好，可以听得到我的声音吗？
可以。
对，
可以好。好，今天非常高兴能够就接受世台会的邀请，我要谢谢那个佩芬会长的介绍。那我们今天这个座谈，是这个系列的第二场座谈。那在上一次的那个上礼拜的座谈当中，我的同事詹素娟还有吴瑞仁， 以及曹老师纪录片的导演陈立贵，他们以这个斗场的世代为题，探讨了曹老师的是生命史跟晚年的特别是有关于认同民族主义的一些想法这样子。那他们是用隐藏文本作为主题来说明曹老师其实是有一个隐藏的文本。一直到他晚年才慢慢凸显出来，他的稿纸的史观事实上也反映了他这样一种隐藏的对于台湾的热爱跟热情。在这样一个前提之下，我们今天其实会尝试从另外一个角度来理解曹永和老师以及他的台湾岛史的史观。我个人当然不否认特别是瑞仁跟陈立贵导演他们对于曹老师的一些看法跟描摹不过我们今天希望可以提供给大家一个更宽广的一个角度也就是希望从全球史跟海洋史的角度来理解曹永和老师以及他的学术跟他的思想那在这样的情形之下，我们很非常高兴，请到活泼可爱的包乐石老师，跟严谨认真的郑维宗老师，师徒两人呢，现身说法，作为当代顶尖的海洋史的研究者，尤其是台湾的早期台湾史跟东洋海域史的研究者。请各位就是以下拭目以待，听听看，他们如何分享个人跟曹老师之间的同学跟互动，那以及他们在各自己的研究以及跟曹老师的很多论学的过程当中，的很多比较深刻的，而且是也许是独家的一些经验跟一些故事，那我想，在两位做完引言之后呢？那我会尝试分享一下我个人对于当代台湾史学史的一些发展的一些个人的一些看法。那然后在这个基础上，我们大家再来共同思考一下，透过 Q&A 的方式来共同思考一下，老师除了作为台湾的曹永和之外，是不是也有世界的曹永和这样一个面向？那我想这个大概就是今天。我跟佩佩会长讨论过之后的一个初步的一个设计。那以下的时间，我想就交给包乐石老师，请他跟大家做一点分享。Professor Blue Say，
好
，You hear me？ OK， it's your time。
好，大家好，我今天大概要用英文讲，因为我好久没有讲中文。可是，我们看一看，一方面中文，一方面英文。
啊，没有问题，没有问题。他们都是在全球各地，所以，no problem， just use whatever you like。
好，那么，I will first say a few words about the family background of Professor Cao。Then say some things about his education, then his career as a librarian, then how I met him and became his second student. 我是曹永和的第二个学生，第一个学生我然后给你们介绍。Then I will talk about the source publications that we were involved in, then about Professor Cao's.Retirement at Taita and his move to the Academia Sinica, this great project over there, but you know better than I, but I will say a few words about it. Then the projects that we did together, Professor Cao and I, and with many friends. And finally, how he looked back at his own career in 1985, because.The notes that I'm using for this talk are the notes that I made from an interview with him in 1985, so 35 years ago, 35年前。那么，我们都知道这两本书，《治学典范》还有曹永和的什么访问记录。
访问记录。
But I still think that the little interview that I did with him still gives perhaps some new viewpoints about him. He told me, and that you can find also in those books, that he was born in Schwerin and that his family had been living there already since the Kangxi, you know. So they were already for 8 generations in Taiwan at the time. And 他的祖先, though, 当老师, 在士林那边, 当了老师, and he also explained to me that Shilin was the original name of it was Bachilan, as you know, perhaps. That is the original name of Shilin is Bachilan, but because there were so many scholars living in Bachilan, they changed the name in Shilin. A beautiful name, of course. Now his grandfather taught the first Japanese teachers who came to Taiwan, Minan Hua, and also Guan Hua, Beijing Hua. 6 Japanese teachers. And all these 6 teachers were murdered in 1896. And Professor Cao said, well, according to the Kuomintang national tradition is these 6 Japanese teachers were killed by Taiwanese freedom fighters. And Professor Cao said, well, we in our family called them Tu Tse, you know, they were just robbers who killed them. Anyhow, his father was the first generation that was educated in Japanese. And he also became a teacher, but then for financial reasons, his father moved to the Taiwan Yinhang. And here we see the first link between Cao Yonghe and the Taiwan Yinhang. It's very important, you know, through his father. At the time, so how should we look at the Cao family at the time? You know, Professor Cao had many brothers, and it was a rather kind of Confucian kind of atmosphere in which he grew up. There were no statues on the altar, only a placard for Kunzi, for Confucius. The Japanese education that Cao Yonghe and his brothers got was not only the education that they got at school, but his father also bought for them Japanese school books as they were used in Japan. You know, the school books in Taiwan were different from the school books in Japan, as he explained to me. But he would teach all his sons the Si Shu in Fujian Hua, in Minan Hua. So Cao Yonghe, when he would read classical Chinese, he often just would read it in Minan Hua. It's very interesting. Well, at the time when he went to school, he went to the Zhongxue, Chugaku. His wife, actually, his later wife also went to the Kotogaku, which was, so she actually had a better education than he himself. But when he finished his Chugaku, he should have continued either to become a doctor, medical doctor, or a lawyer, because there were no other possibilities for Taiwanese at the time, you know, to study at the university. But he didn't want to, and his parents were very unhappy about this. So instead of going to the university or even going to the Kotogaku, he started his own education. And he would walk every day from his home in Shilin to the Zhongtongfu, you know, where there was a big library, and there he would study. And then in the afternoon he would walk back also for two hours. Just imagine, right? So when I asked him, well, Professor Cao, what did you read at the time? He said, "To Luan Han," was just simply reading whatever I could get in my hands. And then he actually planned to go to Xiamen Dashue. He would have loved to study at Xiada, but then the war broke out, so he couldn't go to China. And then he joined a marketing and consumer cooperative, the Shinyo Kumiai. So he spent the whole war working for that cooperative. He didn't have to go, he was not drafted for the army. And he said, actually, the whole family were quite apolitical. Very important, we were apolitical. But then he studied German with the elder brother of his future wife, the elder brother of his wife was also a medical practitioner, and so he had learned German. This man was killed during the war, so that was the first foreign language that he learned, some German. Then he applied at Taiwan University just after Erpa to join the library. And at that time, there still were a few Japanese professors at Taiwan University. Well, you should realize, so this is the Teikoku Taihoku Daigaku, the Tiguo Taipei Dashue, was originally a very important Japanese university, which was focused on the Nanyang, Nanyo, you know, and to East-West relations. So there were a few, at the time, very young and very gifted Japanese professors who wrote some very important books, very important studies, Yensheng Chengyi, Imao Seishi, Kobata Atsushi, you know, all these people. And they didn't have many students, but they actually had all the time to do research. But Cao Yonghe at the time was never able to talk to them, or didn't even meet them. When he started to work at the university, at the library, he said there was a big problem because library system, which was used at the time, was a French international library system, which the Japanese had adopted. And then after the Kuomintang came, then the whole system had to be changed into the Library of Congress system. And so Professor Cao, we call him Professor Cao, but actually we should call him Librarian Cao. You know, the man was originally a librarian and remained a librarian all his life. The only way in which we can understand him is first of all as a librarian. So he was extremely well organized. I'm so happy that he was so well organized. Whenever I came to Taiwan and I would like to see somebody or ask about something, then he immediately had a little card box and he went blah, 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 like that, took the telephone and would call these people. You know, when you are a friendly librarian, or it used to be like that, nowadays librarians are completely different. But at the time, librarians would take a lot of time for you. You know, if you were an interesting student, they would give you a chair and you could pose questions and you could sit down with him. And, you know, and this is exactly what Professor Cao did. So many people would come to the library just to talk to him and discuss with him. Because he had read about so many different subjects, he always had something interesting to say. Right? So he told me also that because of that, that is the reason why he knew so many people. Then there is another interesting thing that you perhaps may not know, but that is his connection with the Taiwan Yinhang. You know these little booklets, right? The Taiwan Yinhang Qingji Yanzhou Si Pianyin the Taiwan Wenxian Chung Kan. He via his father, he became a good friend with the head of the economic section of the Taiwan Yinhang. And that's, I don't know better, I wrote down his name here. Let me see.
Zhou
Xianwen. Oh, yeah, that was Zhou Xianwen. I don't know whether you know him. And so when Zhou Xianwen started with publishing these little booklets, he asked Professor Cao to help him and many other Taiwan university professors, because their salary was very low. This was the way to gain some extra money. So that is how they received income from the Taiwan Yinhang, you know, by helping publishing these little booklets. When I was a student in 1971, still the pay for a university professor in Taiwan actually was very low, very different from what it is nowadays. Anyhow, so then in the 1950s, he started to write articles on Taiwan history, first on the Taiwan deerskin trade, and later on fishery. And when he sent in 1955, he sent, because he wrote everything in Japanese at the time, and until late age, he actually, there was a good secret, you know, he would first write something down in Japanese and then write in Chinese. And I can tell you that without all the help that he got from all these younger people at Taiwan University, especially at the Academia Sinica, the Zhongyang Yanzhou Yuan, he would never have been able to publish his articles and all that. So Professor Cao always, he helped a lot of people, but he received also a lot of assistance, of help from many people. I cannot name, give all their names, but it's very interesting to see how people depended of him and he depended of them. And that is how it should be in human life, isn't it? Huh? It's very important. Anyhow, so then when Professor Yan Sheng Yi, when in 1955 saw this article about the deerskin trade, written by a Taiwanese, he became very interested because he never had had a Taiwan student himself when he was teaching in Taihoku and Taipei. And so that is how Professor Cao got involved again with the Taiwanese professors. So 10 years after the war. And his best friend actually became Nakamura Takashi, from Tianli Dashie, Tianli University. Okay, then his great moment came in 1965, when there was a UNESCO project, the East-West Project, and because he had been reading about East-West relations all the time, he was sent to the conference there. You know, most of these Kuomintang professors at the time, they were only interested in Wu Qianyan, the Zhongguo, Wu Qianyan, Wenhua, and all that. And so they, you know, at the time they said, well, who shall we send to this international conference? Well, you know, Cao Yonghe, he knows about everything. So they sent Cao Yonghe. And that is when his career really took off, because he met some very interesting people at the time during that conference. That was in 1965. And then in 1970, when I arrived in Taiwan, I started to study anthropology. And after when I also took some lessons in Taiwan Hua, Minan Hua. And then at the time, the regulations were quite strict at the time, you know, 大革命是从1965年到1975年，那么我刚好 七零年到了台湾，所以那时候还是很不安全那样。And so then I thought, well, I would like to go to Penghu. And so the first time I went there, I went with my Taiwanese teacher. It was very, very funny. And he introduced me to a few people. And then I went on my own. And then very soon I found out there were all these stories, local stories about the Hongmao Fan, you know, 荷兰的人，就是阿莫焕，你知道阿莫焕的故事啊。
红毛番。
Yeah, and when I came back from Penghu, at the time I still didn't know Professor Cao, but I went to see. I used to go every week to the Zhongyang Yanjiyuan to meet an old lady, Bao Ke Lan, Tai Tai. She was an old Austrian, elderly, yeah, the princess, you know, with.And but her husband was named de Beauclerc, so she had an old, but actually she was a princess, and she was a famous anthropologist who had been working on Quetzal, and after the war she came to Taiwan, and then she was very much interested in the Papal Huan, in the Pinti Fan, yeah.Mm-hmm. Anyhow, so I would go to see her, and I went to see her and told her about all this Hongmao Fan the course. And then she said, well, you know, then you should go and see Mr. Cao Yonghe at the library. And I didn't know about him. Mm-hmm. So when I went to see him, and he was all excited, you know, that there was a real Hongmao Fan coming to the office. Yeah. Now, the funny thing that is for a long time, nobody knew me as Bao Le Shi, but they all called me Hongmao Fan, you know. It went even so far that I went to see Mrs. de Beauclerc's or Dr. de Beauclerc's son, who was serving with the American army in Tainan. And I rang the bell and I said, well, I am Leonard Brisset. I'm a good friend of your mother. She told me that I should.See you. And he looked at me and he said, well, he had no time. And so they said, well, oh, such a pity, because I just came back from Penghu. And then he opened the door again and he said, are you perhaps Hongmao Fan? He had never heard my real name, you know. So and then so from that moment onwards, Professor Cao asked me whether I could help him with some problems in the Dutch language, and I could go and see him at his house in Wenzhoujie, and where, you know, there wouldn't be too many people around, and there we would sit on the tatami. It was a ribbon to the Fangzi, and so I would go there every fortnight, every 2 weeks, and that is how we became very good friends. And then well, I was, I think, 23 or something like that at the time. And he was, he must have been so 50, 51. And when you look at somebody who is 50, when you are 23, you look at somebody who is 51, you're saying, oh, it's a very old man. So, but we became very good friends. And then he said, well, you should not stay here. You should go to Japan. You should go and study with the professors with whom I never was able to study myself. So this was very, very good advice, isn't it? And so, so I arranged to go to Chintu Dashue, and then very soon I met Nakamura Takashi at Tianli University, and I was supposed to go every 3 months or 4 months to Tokyo to report to Professor Iwao Seishi, Zhengsheng Shenyi, you know, who was a 很严格的, very stern professor. And at the time, the first year I did not have a scholarship, so I had to play for the movies, you know, for Japanese movies. And the Toei Kaisha. And Professor Iwa was very unhappy about that, you know, he said I should be a serious student, you know, and the play in movies. But the Japanese needed, you know, foreign faces in their movies. So that gave quite a good income. Anyhow, Then at Temri University, Professor Nakamura Takashi, he was publishing the Batavia Ruchi. Yeah, they have been Batavia Jiki in Japanese. They have been published in translated and published in Chinese too. So, I could help him with making the footnotes for the last volume. And I told him about that Professor Cao at home had typed out all the Zeelandia Castle journals, and that perhaps would be a good idea to publish those too. And then only after I went back to Holland and when I got a job at the university, then I proposed a big international project in which we would also be able to have the participation of Nakamura Takashi and Professor Cao Yonghe, and to publish all the Zeelandia diaries. That is what we did over many years. And with the help of also some people that you may not know, Wouter Milde, who also with whom Professor Cao later lived in Leiden, and all these various people who played a role in that. Because remember, you never do everything yourself. You always need to collaborate with other people. It's much more important to collaborate with others and then make something happen than to try to do everything on your own. I mean, that is the lesson that I have taken from life, and also that Professor Cao has taken from life, right? Okay. Well, what I didn't know at the time, the reason why he sent me to Taiwan, because to Japan in 1970, at the end of 1972, is because he himself went to Hong Kong. So Professor Cao spent in 2 years, in 73, 74, in Hong Kong, engaged in the Da Yue Shi Ji Quan Shu, that he did with, together with Professor Chen Jing He. I don't know, but it's a very important Vietnamese history book. So Cao Yonghe was involved in many more things than Taiwan history of maritime history. Understand? So also he was also a specialist on Vietnamese history. Okay, so when I came back in Holland, I was able to pull off that international project, and we started. Nathalie Evers, it was also a very important person who collaborated with. And we started with the publication of the source material about Taiwan, because Professor Cao and I felt that it was important to provide new source material, right? At the time, you only had Formosa under the Dutch. That was all there was about the Dutch period in Taiwan. And later on, as you know, Zhang Shusheng translated all this into Chinese. That is a very funny story about Zhang Shusheng, because Zhang Shusheng at the time was working for the Wenhua Xue Yuan, and he came to Holland and decided then to establish himself there with his family and his children. And for a long time, he didn't do anything special on history. But then the Taiwan University started with this Taiwan Shidang'an Wenshu Mulu. And we also had to make one about the Dutch period, Holland Shidai, the Taiwan. And Professor Cao and I were asked, can you make such a Mulu? But I really didn't have time, because I was teaching and I was doing completely different things, you know, global history, Indonesian history and all that. And so I went to see Zhang Shusheng and said, well, wouldn't you be willing to do this? And he first was not interested. But unfortunately, his wife said, do it. And that is how Chiang Su-sung became interested again in Taiwan history, and how he then started to translate the Renan's Ruji, so which is an incredibly big contribution to Taiwanese history. So and by that time his Dutch was fluent. You see, the first time he came to Holland, he couldn't speak Dutch, of course, but in the 1990s, after 15 years in Holland, he's fluent in Dutch. So there is nobody in all of Taiwan who can read 17th century Dutch as well as Chiang Su-sung. Also, he was also much better in the end than, of course, Cao Yonghe. And I think the Cheng Kung Dashue 2 years ago awarded a honorary doctorate to Chiang Su-sung. And I thought it was a very good idea, because that should have happened much earlier. Yet his contribution to Taiwanese history is really very important, you know, by translating all this stuff. Okay. Well, then I must say that I didn't visit Taiwan that often for a long time. Actually, from 1980 onwards, I became very much interested in collaborating with friends and later on students at Xiamen Dashue. You know, that was really an interesting place to be, right? In from the 1980s onwards. And you could see the very quick development in Xiamen in the early 1990s was very much like what happened in Taiwan in the 1970s. So I saw this big development happening and a new China coming into being. Like I saw the same thing happening in the early 1970s in Taiwan. Anyhow, the first thing that I thought would be interesting was to get students from Xiata and from China and from Taiwan. And then I talked to Professor Li Yuan about this, of the Zhang Dingguo Qi Jinghui, and he thought that it was a great idea. And so we got a few students from Taiwan and a few students from China, and four altogether. And two of them actually got a PhD, Lin Weisheng, and from China, Yuan Pingling, who has written about the mine workers, the gold mine workers in Pulau in Borneo, in Sikalimantan in Indonesia. It's a very important book. Well, in the early 1990s, I discovered the archives of the Konkwang, of the Batavia Konkwang, which was the Chinese Council of Batavia, which dated from the Kangxi period all the way until the early 20th century. And everybody thought that that archive had disappeared during the Second World War, that the Japanese had burned it or taken it away. But actually, I found it in a temple in Jakarta, and it was very funny. I gave a lecture in Jakarta, and with these many older Indonesians who still spoke Dutch very well, you know, and was a very nice, friendly meeting at night. And then I said, well, and I saw there were many Indonesian Chinese there also who had graduated from Dutch universities before the war and all that. And I said, well, you should realize that a lot of the history of Jakarta, you know, of formerly Batavia, is also the history of the Chinese, of course. It was as much a Chinese colonial city as a Dutch colonial city. But look at the way in which your history is written nowadays in Indonesia. Nobody knows this. And then I said, you see that stone there in the garden, when you turn it over, you will see there is a Chinese text on it, but it has been put upside down. And then I said, and then there must have been the Konkwan archives, and they are lost. And then after my lecture, there was a lady who came to me and said, Leonard, I cannot read Chinese. 我不会看中文，可是我好像知道这个东西在哪里。你要不要看？ I said, of course. 所以我们第二天，我们去那个一个小庙。 而且我们就发现了很多档案在地下，什么的，而且那个房子就是漏水，你知道，漏水，因为那时候有大下雨，你知道，而且就这个18、19世纪的那个档案在地下，在书柜里面，哇，都湿掉了。It was just like only you will read in a adventure book for boys or something like that, right? 那么好，我就跟那边的人说，我们先要买很多这个 plastic， 你知道要 cover all the stuff and so that the water will not fall down it. And I will come back in the summer. 好，and then I actually made a phone call to Professor Tsao and said, the two of us will go to Indonesia this summer, and then we will go have a look at the archive. And he was all excited, of course, you know, fantastic. So this was, I think, in 1991. So Professor Tsao was at the time 70, was he 71? Ito Erlenius, is it? Okay. 好，那我们两个人去叶城啊，and then we started to look what could be saved and what had to be thrown away and all that, and so we arranged that for the people in the temple, and then I said, but because 他们不要印尼人知道。 有这个文献，因为他们怕他们也会把它烧掉了，因为都是华侨的那个档案，是不是啊？嗯。Well, then I said, well, I will think of a way in which we can perhaps 我们可能会包装这个档案，可是我会想办法能不能找到一点钱放在一个有那个空调的那个地方，你知道吗？这样子好。嗯。 所以讲好了，我走了。那么上个星期之后，我在教书的时候，刚好在教堂里面有一个人敲门说：“哎，包老师，很重要，在印尼电话。”所以我跟学生说：“好好好，对不起，我因为我认为可能一个人是病，什么生病了还是那不能这么样。” 所以有一个印尼人的朋友说，他说，老包，你应该赶快来我们叶城，因为他们要把所有的档案送给你，希望你会救这个档案，而且好好的保存下来。所以这个故事是很奇怪。 所以结果我去印尼，我们而且他们有用个两个老先生，他们说在这里是很不安定，你知道，所以我们希望你们来的大学，你们有很多关于这个印尼华侨的那个，所以我希望你会把这个东西带到荷兰去，而且好好的给我们保存下来，还要发表。 要发表，所以要 publish what is important， and 要是你说你会做，那我们就会送给你。 那我只好说好好好，没有问题。说然后我一个晚上都没有睡觉，你知道，因为我怎么办啊？六百公斤的那个档案，你知道？
嗯
，six six six， no， 好像六百，不可能，没有 ，anyhow。60 times 10 kilo. Yes. So, yeah. So, 600 公斤的档案. And so then, so, 而且我然后我就跟赵永辉说，那我怎么办？你们台湾有没有人有兴趣？没有一个台湾的那个研究院那时候有兴趣合作。结果我就跟厦大的那个朋友们。开始编这个编辑这个档案，就是这本书哈，那么我们在20年之内，我们发表了十五期，And then when I applied for money with the Toyota Foundation, etc., then Professor Cao also would help me and talk to his Japanese friends. And so we even got the help from Japan. Then there was an... 因为我可能还要五分钟，好不好？Then there was the problem of teaching. So when first I had these four students, two students from Taiwan, two students from China. And I was not completely satisfied about this because they were always sticking together. The Taiwanese together and the Chinese together. And then I thought the only way in which we can educate young Asian historians, if we get them from many different countries all together and put them into one or two houses so that they will be forced to talk to each other and collaborate and study together. Mm-hmm. And that was the TANAP project. And Professor Cao also played a very important role in the TANAP project. Now, Zhong Weizhong, Xia Xin, Qiu Xinhui, you know, they were all part of this project. And so for in about 15 years time, we were able to have 20 PhD, published PhD theses. Here, you can see my study room here now. And we will walk to these books. So,
室内导引导览
here. So here, can you see it or not? Here you have
yes, we can see
all the PhD thesis, and here you have the Gong Anpu, and then have you here? This is another project we did, the Suni Bouguan.
我们这样看不到，只看到你的头
像。
So you know, so many books we were able to publish, so many books in about 20 years time, and Cao Yonghe, of course, he had his own business, but he always was very much interested, and a great help, and. He was also very he also I took him to Xiamen two times, and he also went there with one of his sons, so that was a great time where there was a lot of collaboration. Nowadays it has become again a little bit more difficult to organize scientific collaboration between Taiwan and 中国大陆，很可惜。不应该这样子，也特别跟福建，你知道，你们应该跟福建，合作，能合作的话要合作。Anyhow, I want to finish with the last part of the interview that I made with Professor Cao, because I think this is important. He said, I have never been influenced by narrow nationalism. I had anti-colonial feelings during the Japanese colonial period. And then, because of that, I wanted to engage in Chinese history. But once we were so-called liberated by the Kuomintang, then I became interested in Western history. So he, 他不想演奏这个五千年的文化的那个中国历史。So he says, so I have never been troubled by a Sino-centric history either, you know. I have always striven to be for a more global, a more or less objective approach. Just like the bluebird of Maurice Maeterlinck. Well, this is, you probably do not know, but it's a very famous story by a Nobel Prize winner, the bluebird of Maurice Maeterlinck. You know, he's a Belgian-French author, which is about a little boy and a girl who want to discover the bluebird. And Professor Cao saw himself as those little children who wanted, you know, to see the bluebird one day, right? Mm. And then he said, it is 1985. Then he said, now I am promoting Taiwanese history. So he had just entered into the Zhongyang Yanzhiyuan. That is my goal. In the Jiang Jiesi period, we could not freely engage in this kind of history. Taiwan studies had not yet come into its own. They were not yet fully developed. And this, and of course, Huang Fushan and those kind of people were at that time also young, engaged scholars who loved to work with Professor Cao. But he says, Taiwan studies has not yet fully developed, but it also becomes politicized. And then he says, love for one's own nation should not show too much in historical research. So it is difficult to have one's own independent political viewpoint even today in Taiwan. He said, I look at Taiwan from its geographical position, an island position in East Asia at the crossroads between China, Japan, and Southeast Asia. But the migration of my ancestors from Fujian also has shaped my personal character. So, 无论怎么样，我也还是闽南人，不管是怎么样，台湾在哪里还是什么，我。 Many people of my age, he said, 他们说，哦，日本时代多么好。 And he said, but I don't have that nostalgic feeling, even if I have a Japanese educational background. The Japanese colonial period had a nationalistic, imperialistic environment in which one could not express oneself as a Taiwanese. One always had to be very careful. But then he said, but in a way, because I am a librarian, this enabled me to freely look at all the books around me. Because I never have been a university teacher, I never have had to explain myself to my students. But then he said, but let us not exaggerate the benefits of being a librarian. The books which I had to purchase for the university were not necessarily the books which I needed myself. So, so I have been building up a library of some San Wan books, you know, 20,000, 30,000 books for his own use, yeah. And as a result, I have been able to develop myself into more directions than any other people in Taiwan of my own generation. 他就是这样说的，所以他那时候在那一方面非常满意。And What I think is so wonderful is that he met at the Zhongyang Yanshou Yuan and at Taiwan University, this whole younger group of scholars, yeah, Wu Micha, Zheng Guotong, Huang Fushan, Zhang Bingzhun was also, he loved Zhang Bingzhun. Cao Yonghe and Zhang Bingzhun, they were also two people, very good friends. But also Liu Xufeng and Professor Cao was also especially enamored by Zhu Delan. And so many other people, you know, that I didn't know myself so well because I am myself not a Taiwan history student, really, which is not completely true, because actually we collaborated also on writing an article together on Xiao Liuqiu. You know, I first wrote an article about Xiao Liuqiu, and then Professor Cao became very much interested by that, especially because I had introduced to him a book by Eric Wolff, which was very fashionable at the time, Europe and the People Without History. Do you know this book? It's still a very important book, because and then I stop, but that is basically why he and I were so much interested in early Taiwanese history. So what do we know about the Yuanzhumin? The Yuanzhumin, they have oral history, but they have no written sources. Mm-hmm. But thanks to the Dong Yindu Gongsi de nege tang'an, we could rediscover the history of the Taiwan Yuanzhumin, which is very important. So these people without history have been given back their own early history. They even can say to the Hanzu, you know, this is our island. I mean, you are latecomers, right? Niemand hoeft ze in mean. This is our island, right? Yeah. And as a result, and you know, and for me as an objective observer, because I don't go that often to Taiwan, sometimes I didn't go there for 5 years, but I saw that the Taiwanese government more and more started to, in its presentation of Taiwan as a nation, you know, as a nation which also belongs to Oceania, right? To the Nanyang. So in that sense, the whole Yuanzhumin Wenhua has been rediscovered, so to say, and given its place in Taiwanese history, and also may have played a role in the Taiwan Tuli Yundung. Mm-hmm. And now the funny thing is that in 在中国大陆,
you know, 谁要怎么用利用这个荷兰档案都是让他们做，那他们就放心了。
Yeah, I think it is very silly to have all these political discussions, historical discussions. Of course, today we are having very difficult political discussions, but that's another thing. I mean, I have always looked at it as an historian, and so did Professor Cao. And in that sense, he has always been an apolitical person. And that is the point that I wanted to make. So that is also where I do not completely agree with the documentary film, you know, where he is portrayed as a typical Taiwanese nationalist. Of course, he felt himself a Taiwanese, and he was happy to study Taiwanese history, but he was not politically involved. I don't think he ever was. He was much too modest for that. Yeah, he left that, rather liked to leave that to other people. But he, of course, would admire other people for taking a political position. But he himself did not like to do so.
Mm-hmm.
好，结束了，就是这样子。
Okay, so thank you very much for your very fascinating portrayal of our joint teacher, Professor Cao Yonghe. 因为时间的关系，我想把下面的时间就交给郑维忠。请他从曹老师晚年的学生的角度再分享一下他的一些看法。那请维忠稍微控制一点时间，这样我们有比较多的时间可以跟大家交流。谢谢大家。哎，维忠，现在请你分享一下。
有听到吗？因为有声音吗？
可以听很清楚。
对，
听到。我在大学的时候，那个曹老师已经在台大有开课了，然后他开的课都是，我记得好像是三学分吧，大概就三堂课，然后他的就是包含了应该大三、大四、硕班跟博班呢、啊。但是我们如果去的话，他每学期都是分组报告，然后你自己提主题，然后报告以后学长姐会评论了、啊。然后我们那时候评论的几个都是谁？都是那个李文良啊，现在在那个历史系，他历史系当主任的。然后陈宗仁啊，然后曹老师的话，他会在等到这些老师都评论、同学都评论完了以后，他可能最后会出来讲几句话。然后因为他那个下课，如果没有记错，好像都是礼拜二，大概5点左右下课嘛。然后，所以我们都会去陪老师吃饭啊。大概5点下课，然后可能曹老师就那个李文良，他就会去订。以前台大附近都有很多那个川菜餐厅。
对。
然后我们就是陪曹老师就去吃个晚餐。然后他因为他那以前他的住宅也是住在那个，也就是温州街那里。然后就吃完晚餐，我们就说不定会陪他再走一下。我是送他回去，这样不一定。那大体上，其实大学的时候也通常也不是这样的。我们有意见，我们也是跟他交流，但是没有很多、欸。通常他都是等到李文良跟陈宗仁他们都评论完以后，那曹老师会给一点意见这样子。那曹老师他呢，就是他，怎么说？他比较，他没有那种学者的价值啊，所以他就是。有什么都跟我们讲，然后可特别跟我们介绍他的藏书啊，然后有哪些学人跟他最近又有联系之类的。然后差不多等到我的意思，他们上他的课以后，我对这个我自己比较有兴趣嘛。那时候刚才包老师也讲了，那时候可以有的书大概就是那个Formosa Under the Dutch， 就是那个 William Campbell 牧师他在。是1900几年的时候的版本，那很早了。那我就那时候就开始读那个东西，然后那个《乱世成日志》，然后那时候德文版的第一集应该在南天书局已经有卖了。然后那时候班上有一个比利时人叫做韩家宝，那他有兴趣，那本身在比利时他用的那个荷语区的荷语就是跟。就是那时候可能就是跟这个17世纪好像也是比较接近。那后来我就对一个词汇很有兴趣，叫做这个 Landa。那 Landa， 那个时候我不知道为什么，那台大那时候刚好进了那个谁，格林兄弟编的历史学词典。哦，很奇怪，19世纪的时候呢，我们现在知道格林兄弟都是那个什么。格林童话嘛，但其实是一个乡土历史运动。然后那个格林兄弟其实编了一套，就是德国历史大词典，那套台大买下来。 然后我就顺手去翻一翻，我发现哎，奇怪，格林词典有对这个 Landau 有解释，然后就开始产生兴趣了。然后后来就找到了不少资料，就写这些文章。那后来这文章现在也是收在那个《台湾史论丛》里面了。然后就在讲这个地方，在讲这个地方集会，这个 Landau， 其实 Landau 就是一个 Standstill， 就我们讲那个法国大革命的时候，不是有三级会议吗？其实它就是完全一样的东西。那在那个格林兄弟的那个字典里面就有讲得很清楚。那我大学的时候，因为那时候学了几年德文嘛，所以那时候就还蛮，就正好可以看到这资料了。那我后来提出这个观念的时候，那时候差不多曹老师他们在办那个2000年那个《Around the Bow for Mosa》那本书，就曹老师80大寿的时候，那曹老师就说："哎，那这个有一个人他可能懂这个东西，那就是包勒。"然后他就去问包勒斯说："那你看这个学生怎么样？"那我就去跟包勒讲说："哎，你看这个 Landau，它就是一个 stand 的这个会议，你觉得这个想法怎么样啊？"那包勒斯就说："哎，你知道这个东西，你讲的没有错这样。"那后来到那个这个前面所讲那个他那计划，那我就去参加这样。他那计划其实很简单了，就是他荷兰的那个档案馆嘛，因为你荷兰过去是一个很大的帝国嘛，啊，当然他有全世界留存下来的档案嘛，他据说是有1000年的档案嘛，因为东印度400年嘛，西印度400年。然后荷兰自己国家的档案可以使用的就超过200多年，加起来确实它有1000年的档案嘛。但是荷兰的档案如果跟英国的相比的话，要不然全世界人他们都会去用英国档案，但大家不太用荷兰啊，因为荷兰语比较难以要去学习的，比较难以接触的关系。那荷兰就是荷兰人他们去整理东印度公司档案的时候，就跟联合国提了一个计划。那你联合国资助我们，那我们也帮你训练学者，它就是一个很聪明的这个计划啊。那包老师当时正好在组织这个计划嘛，所以我就利用这个机会呢，然后就去参加这个他那可能就。好，那个时候我出国之前也写了一本书，就这个制作核磨商，这个就是用的就是现在张荣志老师要去那个台湾历史博物馆，他们那时候收买进来的一批，就是16、17世纪的这个17、18世纪这个老书，还有很多关于台湾的记载。哦，当时他们是想说，那这些记载，他们本来想要写一个题解啊，说这本书啊，它作者是谁啊，生卒年，他说大概内容，他的目录是什么？那我那时候就跟当时那个筹备处的吕礼正馆长就说："哎，你做这个体检没有错，你这做得很严格，但是台湾没有人会有兴趣啊。"所以我就跟他说："那我把它写成一本书，让大家都去了解它的内容怎么样。"好，然后这个书呢，我也去找了那个曹老师去帮我写序哈。那曹老师他本身是很支持这一本书啊。他就是说，他也讲，曹老师也讲说，他一开始他的那个研究到底是从哪里开始？他说他是从这个 Henry Yule 这个育尔爵士写的这个马可波罗传记开始，然后后来在台大听那个桑田六郎的这个交往史啊，所以他其实对这种欧亚交往是很有兴趣的。那后来我在荷兰念书的时候，我跟韩家宝还是继续在做那个台湾的法令方面的研究。那后来就这一本这个《马时代台湾告令集》，就是那时候荷兰人在台湾所施行的种种的那个法令。那这个也是曹老师他非常支持我们去出版的。比如说我们有去统计那个，其实小琉球的原住民有一批女性，后来荷兰人把他们养大以后，嫁给荷兰人了，然后他们的后代都到各地去，也是在雅加达有些到荷兰去。那这个也是曹老师他支持的。 然后等到我这个论文博士不在荷兰快写完的时候呢，我就有就是这本书，好，这本书是也是曹老师，其实是曹老师提出来要做的啊，就是那个立邦上尉的航海日志。为什么做这个？因为荷兰的时候，1622年不是荷兰人来占领澎湖吗？他后来就从澎湖移到台湾，那个时候守澎湖的那一位指挥官，那个上尉就是他，哎，就是立邦。所以他留了很多第一手那时候澎湖事件的资料，还有当时的荷兰的舰队转移到台湾的时候的，那个时候的最开始的资料，他留了非常多记载。那这个内容很有意思，那我花了很多时间把里面的人名、地名、船名都做了这个注解啊。哦，那这都是，这等于是这是包哦，就是等于是包了史老师跟他们。一直很想做的事情，但是在他们手上搁了非常久，那后来终于完成了。那大体上，我大致上能够讲的也不多，大概是这样吧。那我讲一下那个台湾岛史，台湾岛史。那我那时候他在台大开课的时候，这个文章就出版了嘛。那个，就是。张荣志老师编的这本书的头一篇文章，这个叫做《环中国海域交流史上的台湾和日本》。他这个书也是非常的有意思，哦，他主要就是说，其实我们都只要看台湾这一部分嘛，对不对？就是说。这个东亚世界啊，台湾在这海域的交流里面是怎么样啊？然后这个有很多是从这个国家这个单位产生之前就已经有了海上交流，但其实我们看一下的标题是，其实有关日本。为什么我们要提这件事呢？如果你现在看那个市面上的书啊，你比如说看到那个最近八旗他们不是出了东印度公司吗？然后我想想看他们还出了什么？就是最近有几本，就是日本前几年有一个非常大的计划叫宁波计划，啊，就是专门研究这个日本跟中国海上交流的关系。重点是什么呢？重点是日本在战前，它的历史是一个完全是一个国族的历史，到了战后。国族历史还是就是一个 national 历史，国族历史还是个，它以上还是主流，但日本人开始修改，所以最近这几年日本开始重视他的这个，那他发现说，如果你要去更改日本人看世界的这个观点，不再是战前的那个皇国史观呢、啊，然后战后其实战后日本很流行，战后流行的是。马克思主义史观，但日本这个东西也没有什么，这现在看起来也不是，也没有什么用处了。现在所以日本呢，开始就了解说，这个日本这个国家，它甚至它成立国家之前，它跟这个海上周边，它的关联到底是什么？它跟东南亚这些国家关系是什么？它跟以前历史上很久远的这些古代历史这些跟这个周边东亚跟东南亚它的关系是什么？它开始从海上的。观点来看，这都什么时候？反正大概就在曹老师写这个文章的时候开始，大概就这个时候，日本的历史学界有这样子的一个转向，这个转向就已经差不多完成了。如果你去看那个八旗有一本那个海洋的国家，哈，这个日本的就日本人所提的海洋史观，但是这几年，可能已经将近10年了，大概10年前日本已经完成这个转向了。那曹老师写这个东西的时候，其实正好跟日本是同步的，但是台湾没有人搞得懂，哦，因为台湾已经没有人去想说日本人去，台湾没有人去想说日本人会去更动他战前史观的这件事啊。哦，那这件事我觉得很有意思，就是其实这是可以说是东亚一整套的变动，哦，中国不算，哦，因为中国他就走他自己的路，好，哦，他是他自己的事情。那你说为什么东南亚没有这么做？其实很简单呐，啊，东南亚在干嘛？东南亚都在民主化，像印尼2000年才民主化，缅甸到现在还是民主化，泰国可能早一点， 那如果他们都还在民主化转型，他们怎么会想的那么多？他们怎么会去想说他们什么？啊，比如说勉强啊，我最近知道这几年开始编犬死的有个国家就是越南，因为我同学在那里。为什么编犬死？因为他们法国人留下来那一套法国犬死，他们还没有编出一套新的。所以越南现在开始编犬死，但其实东亚国家都还没有开始动。台湾在这里面是一个非常特殊的例子，我就说这有这个，从这个海域观点来看，就是这个，你可以说一个社群，或是一个国家形成，或是一个自我认同什么，你要怎么看都可以。啊，这是一个，就是日本这一边哦，大家都没有去管，但它的历史学已经发生很大的变化。那再来还有什么呢？就是我们说在台湾岛史啊，好像就是岛史。然后这个没有人，就是完全是曹老师独创。你看，代理上没有错，是曹老师独创的没有错。但是其实有一个地方也提过这样的说法，那个地方叫做澳洲。澳洲有一个历史学家，正好也是荷兰出生的，叫做 Frank Bruce，应该 Frank Bruce。
跟着呀，你。
对，那他只有两本书，就是这个。The Bright of Sea，或者 The Gateway to the Asia，他是在澳洲去思考说，澳洲现在独立了，澳洲它的历史到底要怎么去写的这个历史学者，他提了一本书叫做《Island Nation》。你问我什么是 Island Nation？澳洲就是 Island Nation，所以我觉得曹老师他的台湾岛史这个提法，并不是说这世上没有人提过，有的战后有人提过。那这就跟整个东亚的变化是一致的啦。那他这个 island nation 的这个提法，他没有说澳洲就是 form 一个 nation，他是说澳洲在海洋，在各地的跟东亚，尤其是跟亚在东南亚的互动上面，他去形成了这个澳洲的这个共同体的范围了。那这个我觉得也是值得参考啊。那花一点时间，我最后再讲一下哈，那个就是关于这个politics 的问题，就是包勒斯已经讲了嘛，就曹老师他一生他都是 politics，没有问题，他是这样的人没有错，但是我们有一点，包老师可能因为他就是荷兰人的关系，所以可能没有那么敏感，就我还有提到啊，就是那个国民党来的时候，其实那个曹永和也觉得说有很多事情，国民党他们就改，就是说，那个如果你们去看包勒斯这一篇的文章，哦，他上次告诉我们的包勒斯他最近刊出的这个 Ocean，我不会念这个拉丁文的，对不对？拉丁文我不太会念，但重点就是说，中国最近在南中国海，他就一直在 claim 他的主权了。中国在南中国海一直在声称它有从历史以来的主权，那这件事情不是现在才开始做的，它现在已经盖东西上去了，但是它在重写南中国海的历史这件事情已经发生10多年了，啊，因为它是可以，它就持续这样做，就是它的手要伸到哪里去的时候，它就会去重写那个地方的历史。这个是什么时候在发生？这个在南中国海，我们眼睁睁的看它发生了嘛？其实台湾历史就是这么一回事啊。就是国民党他到台湾以后，他就开始重写台湾的历史。为什么？因为以前的那个台湾人自己没什么得写的嘛。那日本人帮你写的，现在二次大战结束了，你就说他都是以前殖民者的东西，所以你也不能弄了嘛。所以没错，就是曹老师他没有自己去涉入政治。但是他对历史的，就作为一个学者的基本立场，他是非常实在的。一个历史学者的基本立场是什么？你要保卫真实的东西啊，就是真实性，我们去保卫它嘛。如果我们讲他们乱讲，至少我们有一个人保住了资料，保住了内容，保住了真实性的东西，保住了有学生未来的人想要了解的时候，他可以找到这些真正的内容。但是我觉得曹老师他做的事情其实就这样，他没有什么特别去写一个台湾的这个一个 nation 到底要怎么，他没有管这个东西， 他只是告诉你说，有一些东西跟国民党讲的不太一样。我觉得台湾通史讲的可能没有 cover 荷兰人的历史这一块，可能没有 cover 原住民的历史这一块。那这都是真实的嘛？那作为一个历史学家，你就是要保卫这些真实性的东西。那曹老师这点做得非常好。那你说 Boris 他的对我们台湾的贡献什么？就是这个贡献呢？因为中国他想要重写你的历史的时候，他不能完全按照他想要做的意志去达成。为什么？因为世界上有其他人知道台湾的历史吗？所以他一定会这么做的啦。他现在在东北，在韩国，他也开始这么写了。在越南，其实日本，其实中国在做那个越南的研究，他也是在重写越南的历史，因为他的国家够大，历史够长，资源够多，文化那么悠久，那么伟大。他要做什么事情，他一定先重写你的历史。但是曹老师帮我们保住了，哦，一线生机啊，让他不能为所欲为啊。啊，这件事情最重要。好，那我就这样讲到这里。
哎，张老师，你的麦克风好像没有开。不过，我可不可以在这里先讲几句话？就是我们刚刚看到两位老师都拿出了很多书籍哈，可是因为现场视讯的关系，我们并没有办法看到那个书名，还有你讲的那些文献。如果说可以的话，是不是就是两位在，就是说在演讲结束之后，可以把您所举出来的那些文献跟那些书单写给我们一下，然后我们可以放在我们的脸书上，让还有兴趣想要看的朋友可以来以后再去找出来仔细的看，好不好？谢谢。然后张老师，
听得到吗？
听得
可以
到。
吗？好，OK。
现在可以，
哦，
谢
因为
谢。
现在已经九点，台北时间已经9:35了，我们希望多留点时间给大家互动。所以我想我尽量简单扼要的分享一下我聆听两位引言人的一些想法，然后我也提供一些我个人的一些看法，那给各位参考，然后我们就尽早能够开放那个 Q&A 的部分，大家可以来互动。我想鲍勒什老师作为曹老师的第二个学生哈，他没有说第一个学生是谁。作为老师，曹老师最好的学生，他从红毛番的那个角度来，非常生动风趣的分享了曹老师的早期的生命史跟求学历程哈。那更重要的是从，他跟曹老师非常多年的在史料整理、发掘、研究上面的一些共同的合作，我想呈现出了一个学者曹永和的很具体的一个风貌哦。那这个是任何口述历史或者是回忆录这一类的文字没有办法提供的一个非常生动的图像哈。那我觉得维中作为一个当代新锐的一个海洋史的研究者，他除了是曹老师的学生以外，他也是鲍勒什老师的学生。那各位可以从他的分享里面，包括从他个人的一个著作，以及他对于台湾岛史观的一个新的一个看法，特别是面对中国的这样一种霸权的论述的这样一种看法，我们也可以了解到曹老师在除了作为一个学者之外，他作为一个史观的一个提出者或提倡者他的一些特性这样子。那我想，如果各位有看到上礼拜的讨论或是纪录片的话，今天的两位引言人其实提供了一个不太一样的一个视野那这个视野大概不是强调台湾史的曹永和，但事实上是强调一个世界史，更重要的是海洋史的一个曹永和。那这样一个曹永和有什么样一些特性呢？我想各位可以仔细再回顾一下纪录片里面或是有关于曹老师的一些生平的一些记录里面所呈现出来的他的一个比较丰富的一个风貌。也就是说，他早期呢作为一个日本殖民时代下的一个自学的一个学者，他在士林学志会的活动里面得到启蒙，然后他在总督府图书馆里面的自学或这个乱读的过程里面，慢慢的开启他的知识的世界。 那更重要的是，他在二二八之后，在战后1947年3月16号进入到台湾图书馆，台湾大学图书馆，开始长达数十年的这样一种图书馆馆员的这样一个生涯当中，慢慢的开启了一个迈向世界、进入世界的这样一个情一个学术的一个根底。那我觉得大家可以从方乐石老师的分享里面可以知道，老师早年的这些累积成前的这样一种酝酿，事实上是到非常晚哦，就大概1950年代他才写出他的第一篇论文，他在1960年代才有机会跟当代顶尖的日本学者接触，到了1970年代才开始在方老师跟各位一些先进的协助之下，开始进入世界。来开始，不管是在荷兰，编《热兰遮城日记》或是在香港跟着陈金河老师编的《大月史记》等等这些东西，在这个时候，1970年代的曹永和早就已经不是狭义的一个台湾史的学者了，他已经进入到世界，他的文章在1980年代在世界顶尖的汉学杂志《通报》上面发表，他也是谈东亚的台湾作为东亚的一个贸易。的一个转口站，一个 entrepreneur 这样一个角度，所以我想今天大家在理解曹老师的时候，除了强调他是一个台湾史的学者之外，我觉得更需要去肯认他作为一个世界的，
对，
台世界史具有世界眼光的一个很重要的顶尖台湾的学者，
对，
这样一个海洋史学者的这样一个角色。那更重要的是说，如果大家接受这样一个看法跟观点的话，那我们可以回过来看一下曹老师在1990年提出来的台湾岛史史观，除了面对当时台湾的政治跟学术的岛内的政治跟学术的情境，也就是说关于国族的认同的分歧或者是台湾史被政治化在这样一种情境或者是说过去的历史都是以汉人为主的中华中心的这样一种历史之外，他除了面对这样一个情境之外，其实他有非常高度的一种新的一种视野，就是他也受到譬如说除了日本的这种海洋史跟交通史的影响之外，其实像法国的年鉴史学、布辽代的地中海世界的这样一种研究，从一个长时段的多重时间观的这样一种全球史的这种角度来看待台湾跟看待台湾周边的世界的这样一种角度，其实也是更值得我们再进一步思考就是所以我个人认为，就是说我虽然赞成我的同事吴瑞仁他所提出来的台湾岛史事实上是一个高度的先进的前瞻的本土的进步的，而且是非本质主义的新的民族主义史观的一个蓝图之外，个人认为就是它同时也具有了一种长时段的跨国的这种区域之间连结的这样一种多重立体时间观的一种全球的整体性的历史，也就是它是一个 total history 的一种看法，这样。所以在这两种看起来相互冲突的不相容的史观里面，其实我们事实上是可以看到曹老师的台湾史观的比较丰富的一些面向。那这也是我们今天在重新去理解老师的学术以及理解老师的史学观点的时候，我觉得应该大家可以在思考的地方。譬如说刚才方老师提到他在跟曹老师在写小琉球原住民的历史的时候，其实他就是用 Every Group 那个没有历史的人这样一个非常重要的一个说法。那这样一个说法其实都不是指单一的某一个特殊的地方或人群的历史，它是一个世界史跨度的讲到资本主义全球化的这样一种情境下面的人或者说那些没有声音的人的历史。我觉得像这一类的问题，我觉得是未来我们在重新思考台湾在世界史中的角色的时候应该是可以思考的一些观点跟角度，这样。 那当然，曹老师的学问世界非常的丰富哦，他懂得语言非常多，他读的书非常的广泛。我们的学生们大概每个人只能大概吸收到一小部分哦，所以我们不太能够代表曹老师来发言，或者说他的台湾岛史是什么。但是我想作为他的学生长期从学的学生，我想每一个人都可以领略到他那种宁静淡泊的这种学风，以及他那种非常丰富的深邃的那样一种学术的知识的世界。那所以在这种理解之上，我想不管是谈民族主义史学或是谈台湾岛史我想应该都会有一些新的一些观点跟看法。那我想，这个也是我是今天想跟大家分享的地方哈。那下面我想是不是就可以开放，大家可以来做一些讨论跟交流这样子？不知道有没有副会长那边会长那边有没有收集到什么问题？
哎，同学，
好
你那边收集到的问题，应该第一个是我的吧？发问顺序，有人在我前面吗？
但是没有，
那我是第
那我
一
们
个。
就问一下，
请佩芬会长先问，对，
直
，OK，
播，对对对，
好，因为
那
我是主办人的关系，我已经很早就赶快抢得头香，嘿。
对，但是我们先问一下直播间的问题，就是有人想要请问郑老
魏忠，
师，就是他好奇日本修正其战前史观的海洋著作，那想请问一下有没有其他相关的书单？
要不然就请郑老师先回答这个问题，我再来提我的问题。
简单
同
讲一
学
下，
们，我们的老师。
那个书单的部分，我们后续会提供给大家参考哈。对，那现在其实也蛮多各式各样的一些海洋史的一些作品哈。对，
所以洪璇他这个问题是主要是要问书单吗？
是的，是的。
那我想书单的方面，我就想三位的话在刚刚演讲中都提到一些书哈，听起来都非常有趣，只是我们现在在视讯的时候远远看不到这些书的名字，或者是没有办法马上大家写下来哈。我想书单的方面，我们就请三位讲者在之后给我们提供一些，让我们作为参考。
名
郑老
字
师，
找
我们，
不是蛮难找的。
哎，对，我
那
们
个
刚刚。
谁，那个东大的小岛裔啊，去找小岛裔先修的书就可以看到了。
从海洋看历史。
在这本，对对，那中岛乐章、小岛裔，对，就他们三个啊，中岛乐章、小岛裔、羽田正，他们是主要的那个，现在主要的代
好，
表
没
人，
关系。
这么说。
对，
好，
我刚刚
佩
你
芬
这
会长，你
个，
的问题是。
哎，我第一个问题是请教包乐石老师哈，就是我们刚刚有听到，就说很多的殖民的国家，或者是说很多的统治者，他们想要去管理一个地方的时候，想要统治一个地方，或者想要侵略一个地方的时候，他们会先去改写他们的历史哈。那我想要知道的就是说，我们一般来讲，我们对于日本殖民时期跟对于中国殖民时期都比较多的了解，他们是怎么进行这些工作。那荷兰作为一个殖民国家，他在就是说他当他到东南亚到台湾的时候，他是怎么来进行这些工作？他是怎么看待当地人的历史，或是他是怎么去了解当地的人？然后他是用什么方式在做他的那个 government，他的 ruling？这是第一个问题哈。那第二个问题是请教张荣志老师哈。您的一个专长也是殖民地各个殖民地的历史，然后您也提过各个殖民地的历史的比较，这方面是不是也可以请您稍微谈一下哈？然后就说各个的殖民地的历史来比较的话，对我们今天有什么样的影响，或者是说您的看法是什么？ 然后郑维忠老师，我这边还有一个问题，就是说，您在《海上佣兵》那本书里面，您有提到，就是说，我记得您有一段话，我觉得印象蛮深刻的哈。您说，如果台湾人不能够深刻体认台湾在全球化的位置，没有办法留意外在结构性的因素对于市局的变化带来的影响，不能够察觉任何因素的交互的作用的后续，那么即使一个历史学家，他们已经很负责的对于这些记载啊，这些历史工作做得非常的详细，非常的真实，那我们也没有办法去掌握到，改变的关键的契机。那我想要请您就这段话，就您自己写的这段话再做一点点阐释，然后如果说您观察今天的台湾，站在一个历史学家的话，您会觉得，台湾现在在全球又占着什么样的地位，然后有哪一些外在结构性的因素您觉得对台湾是比较有决定性影响的？好，那就分别请三位老师。
这三个问题都不是很好答，那我想先请包老师，然后再请维忠，然后我自己在最后再回应这样。
Yeah.
You say we'd like to speak a few words?
Yeah, now, of course, you know, that you pose a big question. So what was the colonial attitude of the Dutch?
Yeah, yes.
Well, it depends. 17th century, 18th century, 19th century, 20th century. It was changing all the time. So in the 17th century, so this was Ming, Mo, Qing, Chu.It's very simple. We were only in there for trade. Maui, you know. But the irony about what makes Taiwan different from all the other places, mm-hmm. is that the Protestant mission played an important role. The Dutch East India Company was not at all interested in spreading the...Christian religion,
mm-hmm.
but for specific reasons that I have been writing about in the past, the Taiwan Yuanzhimin somehow thought were interested in the Christian religion, also for political reasons, you know, not necessarily for religious reasons, but and so the Dutch East Company.East India Company actually had to send in many missionaries. And because it also relied on the missionaries while controlling the Taiwanese people, the Formosan people at the time. Mm-hmm. So it was this is the only colony in Dutch colonial history where you see this happening. So only in Taiwan,The Protestant mission was important.
Mm-hmm.
And now the interesting thing is that, as you know, hardly anything remains from the Gelangsedai, the Taiwan. You know, we have the ruin in Tainan. We have the Hu Mao Zheng in Tamsui.
Mm.
But...The interesting thing is that 2 years ago, an original oil painting portrait of the most important Dutch missionary in Taiwan, Junius, was rediscovered and came and was auctioned off at Sotheby's in, at Christie's in London.
Ah, okay.
And,And this is a very, very interesting painting because you see Junius Musler, you know, while he is baptizing Yuanzhimin, the Heizer. And you see behind him a whole church full of Yuanzhimin. Very, very, you know, it's quite a big painting.
Mm-hmm.
And unfortunately,At the time, I told the people at the Kukung Pooyuan, because they have the most money in Taiwan, and the Taiwan History Museum didn't have the funding for this. So I told them perhaps you know the Jai, the people at Jai.
Yeah, that's the Kugong.
Yeah. So I told them about this, and they tried to make a bidding for the painting. And unfortunately, there were also some other people who were very much interested. And in the end, this painting ended up in the hands of some antiquarians in Holland and England. And now they want to sell this painting, but at a very high price. So finally, the Kukung Poyuan decided that they were not going to buy it. But whatever, you know, may be the case with the price, I mean, you can always discuss prices and all that. But I think it's very sad that the only object which is left from that period at this moment is for sale. And of course, it should be in Taiwan and not in the National Museum in Amsterdam or anywhere else. But
what did you end up? I didn't understand that. I think where is this painting right now?
So it is now back in London.
In London.
Yeah.
Private or Islamic?
So it was sent to Taiwan. You know, so that everybody could have a look at it.
Mm-hmm.
And I was even invited also to give my viewpoints.
Mm-hmm.
Had to go to the Kukung Poyuan in Taipei. And we all agreed that this is a priceless item that should be bought. But actually the price is indeed very, very high, you know. But since then, this antique dealer has not been able to sell it to anybody else.
Mm.
So I think, you know, in 2024, it will be 400 years ago, right? That, that
yes.
Dutch arrived in Taiwan. And
mm-hmm.
I think it's very important that people, you know, the museum people in Taiwan should not give up, but go back to the negotiation table and talk to these people, because my private view, my own view is that these antique dealers will never be able to sell the painting for the high price that they ask.
Mm.
And this painting should not end up in a private collection or in a Dutch museum, because it was actually also made by a Chinese artist. It is very, very interesting.
Chinese artists or original people?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
And you see, Wei Jun perhaps can show the picture right now. I don't know, you know, don't you have it on your computer? But anyhow,
it's in my home.
Yeah, but it's very special.
Yeah, we'll try to show it later. When we find
the image, if he's going to this Taiwan Historical Museum, then he could probably borrow the painting to make a display there.
Yeah, well, and then the first question, which was posed, why am I the second student of Professor Taiwan Cao Yonghe?
Yeah,
I said, why am I the second student? You know, so who's the first student? And he said, what a tie tie.
Well,
but we also know, we also know that his wife is actually has made a big contribution to his work too. Because without her, he wasn't able to do his research as he liked.
Yeah. And so, you know, there are two things which I have not been talking about, but perhaps which I should say very quickly now. First of all, he was always deeply in love with his wife, and his wife was a fantastic person, very intelligent person. And unfortunately, she fell ill, and she was ill for a very long time. And this was a big tragedy in their household.
Mm.
So, you know, for something like 20 years, nurses had to nurse his wife, you know, at home. So that was very, very tragic. Another part of Cao Yonghe that we have not discussed is that he and his brothers suddenly became very rich in the 1980s. And yeah, this is something that we should tell, because how is it possible that there is suddenly a Cao Yonghe Foundation, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now the secret behind all this is that one of his brothers had bought a lot of shares in the a company that he was working for, insurance company.
Oh, okay.
And so in the 1970s and 80s, when the Taiwanese economy took off, suddenly all these brothers became very rich. Now, what did Professor Cao do? He said, I don't need this money myself. So he said, I will divide it up between my three sons.
Mm-hmm.
So the money is for them, but I also want to put apart some money for a teaching way.
Mm-hmm.
And so it is the responsibility of the sons to take care of the teaching way, and they have to take care of me. So I give everything away. And then he told me, as long as I can buy some books. So, and this is very typical, that you have to realize that in America or in Europe, when you give somewhere a lecture, or whether you are present at a lecture, you never get any money. You know, perhaps you are invited for dinner, but that's all. You don't get money.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the funny thing is that in Taiwan and in Zhongguo Dalu, you know, if you give, and that I'm very happy for that, you know, if you give a lecture in Taiwan, also as a foreigner and all, you always get some money. You get an hunbao, you know, you get an envelope.
Mm-hmm.
And the point was that as soon as Professor Cao became a yuanshi, wherever he participated in events, then they would give him money. And that money he used immediately to buy new books. it was very funny. Because I said, why do you go to all those meetings? Well, he said, because they give me money, then I can buy books. and his sons, you know, well, they took care of him, but they didn't give him money to buy books. So that was the way in which he could always continue to buy books. And in the 1990s, then you could buy in private bookshops all kind of books from Zhongguo Dalu, right?
Mm.
So he would go every day to the little bookshop, see if there's any new books from China. And that is how he collected until his final days.
Mm. A beautiful very, book life.
Yeah, he was. It was almost like a book illness, you know.
Mm.
Yeah, yeah.
谢谢那个包老师哈，那曹老师的确是一个书痴啦。对，那他1998年获得中研院。院士的荣衔之后，在1999年就成立了曹永和基金会。
Yeah，
那刚才包老师提到那个很重要的那个公案部的事，后来出曹永和，也提供了重要的那个、yeah. 就是奖的金的那个出版经费、哦、那下面我们就请维中分享回应一下那个佩芬会讲这个非常难的问题。
很难吗？
没有什么困难的、啊。如果你们看我的书，你们就会发现说，你会发现说那个荷兰人攻打台湾的这个情况，我大概写了不到一页，对不对？好像，但是老实说，过去我们可能我不知道说是不是至少50年来，其实大部分我们关于荷兰人的事情，就是只知道荷兰攻打台湾的那一年的事情。哦、然后现在就想到什么哪个时候发生炮战啊，哪个时候有什么俘虏跑过去啊，中间有哪个牧师死掉啊，是不是我们知之甚详？那我的书为什么不写？因为就是因为这一句话， 影响台湾。我们现在是一个民主国家，民主国家的意思就是说，大家的命运，大家共同命运是大家共同要决定。以前古代不是这个样子，所以以前的人他们命运怎么发展，就是那些国王、那些领导者，他们去决定就是。但现在不是，现在台湾民主国家，民主要大家决定大家的共同命运。那你这个历史要对大家有帮助，你其实要让大家去思考你的共同命运的事情。你的共同命运并不是哪一天有牧师什么被处死的，那并不是哪一天有人走出去，哪天走进来，哪天跌倒，哪天刷牙，哪天上床睡，哪天 早点睡，哪天晚点睡，那都不是你们要，都不是大家要关心的。大家要关心的是哪些事情造成大家共同命运的转变嘛？最近有一本就是 很不错的书啊，有一本林孝信写的《意外的国家》哦，那他就是讲了，就台湾这四五十年来，他形成民主国家的过程是怎么样在国际体系里面去造成的。他可能不是故意造成的，但他有很多，他就是决定了你的发展。这是台湾人以前不知道，现在要知道为什么？因为台湾以后，如果你就真的民主了，你就是要是。台湾人如果自己不去了解这些事情，你做出来决定别人还是要接受这个后果。如果全台湾都公投说他要统一，就是让他统一了，对不对？那你台湾人没有 做到充分告知、了解这个历史的时候，你要怎么做这些决定嘛？那你就算不想独立，就是不想统一，那你到底要怎么去做？你不去了解这些外面的这些结构性力量，你要啊，你怎么去？怎么去做决策？怎么去投票？怎么去选？怎么去实行政治啊？你去看我的书，会发现说，这跟家里什么谁跟谁吵架啊，或是谁有没有什么大太太、小太太，或几个儿子，或什么这些事情，或谁的好，谁品德差，那东西我都不是很 care 了。我们现在就是你去看林孝信那一本，个人有个人的这个性格什么的，就在里面会有一些影响，没有错。但主要影响台湾这一大群人共同命运的，这个陈翠莲老师也讲过了，叫政治的一个体系啊。所以你们去找陈翠莲老师的书，就会看懂。那我写这个书呢，就是。那个观点呢，其实跟曹老师一样嘛，就是关于有一些历史，它不能让随意去写，因为你至少还有荷兰人的资料去证实他说大体上的情况是什么。当时的国际结构有好几个层次嘛，有一个中国日本的层次，有一个荷兰西班牙的层次，还有台湾跟东南亚的层次啊。它至少就有三层的国际关系啊，这些东西就会影响你这一群人的命运啊。你要去看历史变化的时候，你要去看影响你们这一群人命运的是谁主。如果就台湾来讲，它是一个，所以它外在就是非常重要。那这个人的选择大概是什么？这会不会影响？有一点影响，但没有那么大了。那我所讲的就是一个那个，这叫 priority 跟 relevance 的这个问题，就这么简单而已，没有什么特别。
谢伟忠啊，那我想我也简单分享一下我非常粗浅的看法啊。那我认为，台湾特别从1980年代以后，发展出来的这30年来出现了一个新的台湾史的一个研究领域。它事实上是台湾，它跟台湾的民主化、公民社会的这种成立，事实上有非常密切的关系。所以它跟解严前，或是跟之前的不同的政权下面所生产出来的这些知识，虽然有关系，但事实上在本质上事实上非常的不同。所以，在这种情况之下，我们如何从当代的一个角度回去再看，不同的历史时期，殖民政权。他们在台湾所留下来的这些资料、观点或是作品、乃至于、比较深层的一些政治、经济、社会方面的影响、事实上就是、当代台湾史研究者所必须要面对的问题、那我个人的观点是，简单来讲，如果我们要仔细分书， 当代台湾历史学的几个重要的一个知识的传统的话，那事实上至少有四个不同的传统，值得大家重新去检视、批判和继承、或是超越这样。那第一个当然就是、中文史料为主的、中国、明清的方志、或中国的地方史跟战后的这种边疆史的这种研究、那第二个呢，就是以日文资料为主的有关于日本殖民地的研究跟战后的包括发展途上国研究等等这些日本的、这样一种殖民地研究的传统。那这些传统跟、日治初期的卢府、冠习会、日治中期、日出关这些地区、那第三个传统呢，事实上就是英美以这种西方的多语文的资料为主，从十九世纪的这种探险、贸易、外交博物学的这些记载，一直到战后1950-60年代的这样一种以现代化理论跟这种区域研究 area study 为主的这样一种区域研究的这些传统。但是除了这三种比较学院式的这些知识传统之外，当代台湾历史学还有一个更重要的、一个传承或者一种精神上的一种连结，那就是台湾、不同时期的台湾人在面对或反抗殖民政权的过程当中所生产出来的这些比较本土性的历史知识，它包括日本殖民时期的这些反殖民运动的这些论述、或是战后在戒严时期的各种反对运动的论述，乃至于在海外的这种政治运动的论述，更重要的是从70年代以后、一种民主化的这样一个过程当中，关于台湾历史的重新的理解跟书写跟讨论乃至于辩论。那这上述四种不同的传统共同构成了当台湾历史学的知识，在言论自由的情境当中，台湾的新一代研究者可以利用这些资源，那包括在曹老师还有我们前辈学者的引领之下，来共同思考一个如何重新岛屿的人民跟土地的角度去思考，去重新撰写一个属于大家的一个台湾岛史。我想这个是我个人的一些、比较粗浅的看法这样。那下面我想继续、看看是不是有、一些新的问题跟讨论。我看到已经那个、有一个留言很久，就是、
有一个问题比较早，就是
对对对，
好，我来念、
说明一下，
我来念一下这个问题。这个问题是想要请问张志龙教授跟他薪资相关的历史问题，就是228殉难律师汤德章在台南的故居可能因为不被认定是古迹难以永续保存，这项议题应是台南市政府与文化部门来处理。台南历史博物馆身为台湾历史记忆收藏与再现重地，是否能为此项议题做点什么？
因为我那个4月1号才会正式上任，我想我会非常关心这件事情。不过我要跟您报告说，目前那个国家人权馆、像陈俊宏馆长等等，他们、其实大概在明后天、就会到台南去实地了解这个情况，希望能够比较妥善的处理。那关于这个故居的保存，其实、除了它的历史价值跟、这个汤泽章张德章律师作为一个重要的历史人物的这个部分以外，其实还牵涉到、比较具体的一些、包括这个、实际的历史建筑的认定、以及他这个、这个住宅本身、牵涉到的一些财产、等等民事方面的一些问题。不过这些问题我想都是可以慢慢处理、我想那个人权馆的部分已经、开始努力，那我想未来台史博也会参与协助，希望这件事情可以比较有比较好的一个、解决的方案。谢谢。下面，我看到那个在那个文字的部分有一位听众提出来一个还蛮重要的问题，我想直接念一下。那如果那个维忠或是邦老师可以的话，请就协助回答哈，就是在东南亚的贸易体系下，有学者提出曼达拉模型的这个贸易网络，这个很大的这个网络。那当中并没有包含台湾。那另一方面就是日本的滨下武志教授，他有这个朝贡体系的这个理论体系，那特别强调琉球啊、中国大陆这些藩属的关系等等。 那这位听友认为，这是目前既有的岛屿史观，那要如何从这两种看起来似乎冲突的世界贸易体系下，谈台湾的海洋史的历史及贸易关系？那我们又应该要参考哪方面的资料？维宗，你帮我简单谈一下。这个问题怎么？说过就好了。对。
我最近帮这本书写了一个推荐序，然后，那你的问题其实有点，你说满当然没有包括台湾，然后琉球跟中国成，这两件事情没有什么关系啊。对的，这两个前提跟你后来的问题跟后来的台湾，那你有什么关联性？我老实说不太懂啊。
这位朋友，现在我们的那，好像也是在线上吧，哈，你要不要自己再把它讲清楚一点？对，我其实是清大的，是谢学生，然后我以前也上过邱兴老师的课，我目前在慕尼黑念历史，但是我并没有特别针对台湾史的部分。然后张伟忠老师，我们其实以前有在巴黎还有几次研讨会见过面。
嗯，郑伟总，对，然后，我的问题是，假如说，我们需要用一个类似像岛屿史观的中心来看的话，那应该用哪些东西，哪些资料作为方法论来探讨说台湾是在这个贸易体系之内？
这其实是蛮真门的问题，维宗，你要试着先回答一下。啊，如果，我这边不够的话，我也过来可以跟你再交流，对。 是那个黄庄国的一篇，在网站的出来的。我念一下好不好？在哪？好，在这。曹老师写的，在这现在有在这个收在这里面了，就是张荣志老师编的这本书，《岛史的求》。 求所上面啊，然后这里有一篇《环中国海域交流史上的台湾汉语》，大体上如果你有什么疑问都在这里面呢、啊。那他有提出一个假说了，那他认为就是说这个，是断线了吗？你们大家有听到吗？ 还可以，还可以，没问题。有，听得到。哦，他这有都写了哈。我看，然后还有一句话写的，还是那个龙志兄的游戏。 对，它前面有一个东亚海上交通史与史前文化，然后后面有这个近世东亚交易圈与东西交通，对，所以其实大概这里都已经有提到了。那我就举这里，
对，我想就建议您可以先参考一下。
最后一段呢。 如上所述，16世纪，使英中日直接交涉的通道断绝，因为欧洲诸国人陆续出现在东亚海域，于是，在中西贸易的纠葛当中，曾其在环中国海域隔绝的孤岛台湾，由于其地理位置的重要性为列国所认识，终于被荷兰人领有而成为。
殖民地和成为荷兰人的亚洲贸易的中日贸易的基地，自此台湾进入了历史时代。那他写的其实蛮清楚的。我想简单补充一下，对，如果有问题，你可以直接跟回中啊，没有在讨论哈。那，曹老师的台湾岛史，我觉得有一个很重要的一个特色，就是说。 在目前，它是被当作台湾主体性史观的一个很重要的一个典范在处理哈。那这个主体性史观其实比较强调的是台湾的历史发展的特殊性，或者说台湾人的主体性。 或是台湾文化的海洋的这种特性等等。那这些部分我想基本上并没有太大的问题，但是我想今天从邦老师跟维中的分享里面，你事实上是可以看到曹老师的台湾岛史观的另外一个其实也更重要的一个侧面，也就是说台湾岛从来就不是一个孤立的一个岛屿，它事实上是跟周围的岛、跟周围的海洋、跟周围的陆地、跟周围的地缘政治等等，刚才维中所讲的那种结构性的因素有密切的关联，所以而且它的位置在不同的历史时期，从史前时期到早期到近世近现代到当代，它的位置相对位置其实是不断的在转变当中，它有时候是被孤立在主要的贸易线之外，那有时候又会进入到很重要的这个贸易线之内，所以它是一个变动的一个关系，它是一个就是结合了历史脉络跟结构的这样一种发展的历程，所以我是觉得从这样一个比较动态的结构结合结构的角度去了解台湾岛跟了解台湾史作为一种连结的历史，一种 connected history 的这种角度去再去思考相关的一些史观，我想会比较有助于就比较片面的去把一种民族史台湾主体性的论述的原型，我想这两种没有冲突，但是是像是做一点补充说明。那下面不知道还有没有什么问题可以再交流一下，如果没有的话，我想是不是请邦老师你要不要再分享一些有趣的秘辛或小故事，让我们多认识曹老师。听不到，听不到。
您现在好像麦克风要开一下。
Yeah, please open up your microphone. Can you, ma'am?
The below is this. You can see your microphone, the green one.
那在那个邦老师在寻找麦克风的时候，维中要不要分享一点你的一些任何跟曹老师相关的故事或是回忆？
对，这样好吗？先
可以啊，可以啊，没问题。
Yeah，
太好了，行。Yeah,
OK，
no problem。Yeah，
yeah， 没有。About the position of Taiwan as an island and about the Taiwanese identity in from looked viewed from an historical background. There is, of course, a certain irony that Taiwan appeared so late in East Asian history compared to all other surroundingcountries. You know, I, of course, the Taiwan Yuan Zemin had their own history until the Ming Chao Monian, but nobody knew about it outside Taiwan, right? And then Taiwan was, so to say, pulled into global history, either by Chinese orJapanese smugglers, or the Spaniards and the Dutch East India Company. Quite suddenly, only in the, you know, in the beginning of the 70s, only 450 years ago, it is 470 years ago, that makes Taiwan very, very special compared to other places in Asia. Now,why were the Dutch interested in Taiwan? Because they could not trade directly with China. So they needed a place near China where they could open up their business with China and with Japan and with Southeast Asia. And that is what they did for, what is it, 35, 40 years, until they were kicked out by Chen Zhengkong. Yeah. But the interesting thing is by that time, Taiwan already had lost most of its value for the Dutch East India Company because the China and Japan were directly trading with each other. They did not need any more Taiwan as a Zhongjianren, you know. So you see what you see happening is then you get something like, well, Deng Weichong has written about that 20 years of Zhengjia de Taiwan, you know, Zheng, it really was like a kingdom, the kingdom of the Zheng family.
Mm.
Well, then Taiwan was swallowed up, you know, by Shulang, by the Qingzhou, you know, but also in a very funny way, because actually, as Deng Weichong also describes, you know, the Chinese government really didn't know what to do about Taiwan, you know, but then you get this whole migration, popular migration from Fujian. So then Taiwan becomes something like the Wild East, you know, like you have the Wild West in America. Taiwan was the Wild East of Fujian, right? But then as an island and always keeping its own identity. Well, then you move into the period of imperialism. And then the Japanese say, oh, you know, we need Taiwan in order to open up the door to the Nanyang. So mm-hmm. then they made use of Taiwan. And then afterwards, the Kuomintang moved in. So this is a very unique history. I mean, that is what makes Taiwan such an exotic place in global history, you know. It's very special. And that is what your identity is about. You have been manipulated by many different countries. Well, what the future will say, I don't know. But this makes Taiwan, and why is it like this? Because it is an island. If it would have been part of the global, part of the territorial mass of Asia, you know, part of the continent, it never could have happened like this. Just mm-hmm. because Taiwan is from a geographical point of view, it's an island. And that is what makes it so special. It is not that, for instance, Taiwan has a very long maritime historical tradition or something like that, you know, with Taiwanese sailing all over the world. No. Other people were sailing to Taiwan, strangely enough. Apart from the Zhengjia, you know, but they moved in from Fujian. So this geographical position of Taiwan gives its special identity, its special meaning. And right now, on the global scale, here we see again that Taiwan becomes a play ball, so to say, kicked around by global and international policies. Because of course, strategically speaking, it's there on the main sea route to Japan. And all the traffic moving to Shanghai, you know, passes, you know, through the Taiwan Straits. So the only way in which we can look indeed at Taiwan within global history is look at Taiwan as an island. And that is, I think, what Cao Yong-he meant when he was talking about an island identity. You see what I mean?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
If you disagree, tell me. Yeah.
I totally agree. Yeah, because in the very article that I chose for the collection, Daoshi de Joshua, that Weizong just mentioned, is exactly Professor Cao. That's exactly what Professor Cao told us in that article. So, 包老师最后的这样一个陈述，从一个历史发展的一个角度来说明。曹老师的台湾岛史在 台湾作为岛屿的这个地理特性上，对于历史所产生的影响，以及台湾这个特殊的多重殖民跟这种多重移民的这个历史中所呈现出来有关于台湾认同的这一些特性的讲法，我想也可以为今天的座谈会算是一个非常好的一个结语。那在因为已经快要台北时间10:30，我想维中你有没有什么最后的补充想要跟听友们分享或是建议可以简单讲一下。
你有问我说我对曹老师有一些回忆吗？对不对？我刚才突然想起了一件事情，当然也不是什么重要事啊，就曹老师在那个台大做图书馆员哦，然后有一件事情他觉得很困扰，就是以前那个他做馆员的时候，常常会有一些不明人士啊，跑到台大图书馆去查校友录啊，好像是什么大陆很多奇怪地方的校友录，你知道这些人知道干嘛？这些人会冒名顶替，然后就是冒着这个名字，冒着学历，然后他们就去找工作，那就是那个乱七八糟的台湾的年代了。他知道他是非常聊这种事情的人。那如果他隐藏成本的一部分呢，我想我也是能够接受。就是那个时代人看了太多乱七八糟的事情，他们看了那么，曹老师看了那么多乱七八糟的事情。他能够坚持的没有同一个他该做的事情做，我觉得了不起的事了，就是这样子。好，谢谢。对，
这还蛮劲爆的。
谢谢维中的分享哈，我想，我作为一个引言人跟串场人，我想我也做几点补充，然后我们就正式结束今天的座谈哈。那我想。今天的主题是台湾岛史30年。那我们是在上一场，也就是曹老师纪录片的关于生命史的讨论的基础上，来延伸进一步思考曹老师的思想跟学术，跟他对我们的一些影响跟贡献。那我想从包老师跟维中的分享里面，我们可以看得到，如果从一个海洋史更重要是从一个全球史的角度跨国史的角度来思考台湾岛史的话，事实上是可以提供一些在民族主义史学史观之外之上的一个新的一个观点，这两种未必有冲突，但事实上也不太一样。那这是我想这是第一点哈。那第二点就是说具体的将台湾岛史应用在台湾史或是相关的历史的研究的解释跟书写上面的话，其实今天两位引言人跟大家的讨论都可以看得出来，他事实上是一个非常具有启发性的一个观点。他虽然不是一个严谨的理论体系哈，那他可以帮助我们一方面了解，从一个结构的角度去了解台湾政治史发展的这种高度的断裂性，那以不同的政权在台湾岛上所留下的这些不同的一些影响。以及他们累积性的这种效果，还有台湾作为一个帝国周边或帝国夹缝当中的一个存在，它怎么样受到地缘政治的一个外在的结构性的影响。但另外一方面更重要的是作为从一个土地跟人民出发的这样一种在地的一种史观台湾的社会史的这种连续性，也就是不同的族群在不同的时期以移民的形式来到台湾，然后不同的族群之间相互的冲突协调融合，来自于共同创造一个新的政治共同体或命运共同体这样一种历史也就是说政治史的断裂跟社会史的连续的这样一种特殊的一个情境，我想也是台湾岛史一个很重要的特征。那我想最后我要谈的就是其实台湾岛史，如果我们从一个老师很喜欢引的布劳代的地中海世界的这个研究来看的话，那依据法国年鉴史学第二代大师布劳代的讲法，就历史特别是政治史，其实是只是大海上的浪花上的这海浪上的浪花而已，这个政治跟世界那其实还有很重要的是中间那一层的社会跟经济的趋势的发展跟变迁它的周期事实上是比政治史更长更深远的但是除了政治跟社会经济的这个面向之外，它一个比较深层的地理的环境的这些因素， 它的周期可能是百年甚至数百年在变化的。所以我是觉得未来在台湾岛史的时候，有关于台湾的环境史啦、生态史啦、人跟环境、人跟生物之间的这种互动，人跟自然资源的这种互动，应该也成为我们在台湾讨论台湾岛史的政治性的之外的一个很重要的一个观点。总而言之，我觉得今天特别是包老师跟维中为我们所呈现出来的这样一个台湾岛史跟曹老师的这样一个学术世界，事实上是一个非常丰富的，不只是政治的，也不只是学术的，不只是个人的世界。那我愿意用今天大家不断提到那个很重要的一个计划，就是个他来那个计划，荷兰的那个计划，他培养了一批很重要的一个新生代的学者的这个计划。这个计划其实它的完整的名称是叫做 For the New Asian Commons。它是一个建构一个跨国的新的学术网络的这种前瞻性的计划。它不只包括荷兰，它也包括不只包括亚洲，它也包括南非这样一个跨国的这种研究计划。那我们期待未来有关于台湾岛史或者台湾史的研究，也能够发挥这样一种精神，不同世代的学者带领了新世代的学者，用具体的研究跟作品开创一个跨国的这样一种世界史的一种视野。那我想这个是应该也是不管是曹老师或包老师很希望看到的一个学术的愿景。那我想作为年轻世代的学者，我想维中已经有一个很好的表现，那我们也期待新的世代能够在这个部分继续努力。那今天非常谢谢大家来参与这个非常生动活泼但是又非常深刻的一个座谈会，我个人也获益良多。那我想就把时间交回给佩芬会长，谢谢大家。
谢谢三位来宾。
谢谢。
我想刚刚我很感谢张龙志老师的最后的结语哈，我仿佛看到国立台湾历史博物馆馆长的一个宏图。我觉得
欢迎大家到台南来看看展奉茶的。对，
好。
我觉得就是历史是一个非常重要的一个领域，它不仅是一个学术领域，也是我们人跟我们的世界、跟我们的过去、跟我们的未来要发生关系的连结点。那我们很高兴，就是说看到今天大家的分享，也给我们有非常多非常有趣的思考的一个方向。那像我刚刚说的，我们很希望三位老师把您刚刚介绍过的那些书，也许就是说用 email 寄给我们，我们再把它整理出来放在我们的网页上，跟放在我们的脸书上面，让我们的读者还有机会可以再进一步再去看这些文献哈。那我想今天这是我们两场座谈会的第二场，我们第一场是以曹老师的生命史为聚焦的焦点。那这一场的话，我们很高兴可以就是说兼由三位的介绍，让我们看到就是说曹老师他其实作为一个历史学者哈，他的那个视野，他跟他的那个眼界哈。那我觉得很有趣的就是说他跟就是说包老师老师刚刚他所分享的就是说就是说你说曹老师他从来不是一个受到狭窄的民族主义影响的一个学者，但是他在90年代提出来的时候，我们也听到吴仁老师跟我们分享说，他说台湾那个时候需要民族主义哈。那我觉得其实这个表面上看起来有冲突的东西，也许我把这两个我自己从这两场演讲中看到的这两个这个好像看起来是一个矛盾的东西，我想就留给大家去思考。好，我们应该就是说我们在我们看历史的时候，我们的态度是什么，然后我们不仅看历史以后，我们要提出来的是要怎么去面对历史，面对现在这个世界，然后面对我们未来的任务。好，那我想很高兴我就把这个作为一个结尾，大家停在这一点，然后非常谢谢大家的分享。 然后大家如果说有兴趣的话，觉得今天的活动很不错的话，麻烦您到我们的脸书去按赞。然后我们的这两场座谈会也都在网上，好，在您就是直接到我们的直播网上就可以再次把它拿出来再听。如果还有什么东西没有听清楚的话，大家还可以继续的看。然后纪录片是到这个月的3月31号截止，好，那这几天大家还有一点时间，如果说想要再看一次，大家再回味一次的话，好，欢迎大家继续的深入的观赏这样子。那谢谢大家，然后我们祝大家周末愉快，然后复活节愉快，好，
拜拜，
再见。
Thank you very much for the blue thing.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks.
好，大家如果要开个麦克风说再见也是可以的。
大家再见。
谢谢你们哦，辛苦了。
谢谢，谢谢，
谢谢，
谢谢你们，谢谢你们，
谢谢
你们，
拜
拜，
拜
拜，
谢谢，
好嘞，再会，
拜，
再见，
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 嗯，拜拜，
拜，
再见哦，嗯。亲你哥，辛苦了，辛苦了哈，佩佩，
不会，
很棒。
谢谢。